Today, amongst other things, we'll take a look at SpaceX's Starship serial number 15 and what's going to happen with it. Will it fly again? Will it be scrapped? When is the orbital flight going to take place? We'll also take a look at Virgin Galactic and their recent spaceflight with VSS Unity and what kinds of implications it has on space tourism.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. A lot is happening in Boca Chica. SpaceX is working towards its first ever fully reusable launch vehicle, and the time of small steps has long passed. And here we are again, Boca Chica, Texas, SpaceX Starbase. If you don't know what that stands for, take a look at the last episode, where I did a deep dive into why SpaceX is building this in the first place. We're looking at the suborbital test facility here, the old tank farm and the two suborbital pads A and B. Starship serial number 15 is currently sitting on suborbital pad B, going through some modifications. It's still unknown if it will ever fly again, as stated by Elon Musk, or what's going to happen with it in the future. And this is work being done inside serial number 15's engine skirt. To be more precise, an engine is being removed, Raptor number 54. By now, all three Raptor engines have been removed from Starship serial number 15, and it's unclear what's going to happen next. There are a few options right now. After its very successful flight, serial number 15 is in a waiting position now. Musk stated that the team might try to refly this prototype. This would be yet another first, as no Starship has ever been flown twice yet. For this, SpaceX would need to make sure that it's safe to fly it again. I expected the removal of all three engines for some time now. They at least need to be thoroughly checked before any reflight can be done, and that can be done best at the construction site, and there still is the rumor that one of them didn't properly relight on the serial number 15 flight. Replacements might be needed. Another possible option would be to retire Starship serial number 15 and go with serial number 16. As seen here through Mary's lens for NASAspaceflight.com, it's sitting inside SpaceX's high bay right now. Stacked and apparently ready for a flight. Ready to show the world that a landing can be done again. At some point, SpaceX will need the space as well. The high bay can only hold so many prototypes, and SpaceX does have some very important ones to finish here soon. SpaceX's production line doesn't look like it would stop anytime soon. More and more parts for all sorts of prototypes are being manufactured. Besides the progress on serial number 20, which is supposed to fly to orbit for the first time, we can already see first parts for serial number 2021, which of course is going to try its luck as the second Starship to fly to orbit. Likely built in the same way as serial number 20, it will be a backup candidate for SpaceX, which will likely be needed as well. Musk has already stated that several Starships will be needed to figure out the heat shield, the orbital re-entry, and the complete recovery. There will be plenty of flights here in the future. Meanwhile, at the construction site, SpaceX has been busy working on the next booster. BN3 is taking shape, and it will likely be the one to carry Starship serial number 20 up to its first orbital flight. And this is one of the coolest pictures taken by Mary in a while. It's the perfect peek through the fence, and it shows the first picture ever of a super heavy fuel distribution system. The system will be comprised of two levels. The lower level for the 8 center engines is going straight down. The upper level of another 20 pipes will feed the outer and fixed engines on the booster. Taking a look at one of RGV Aerial Photography's pictures where we can see the booster aft dome, the system becomes apparent easier. Here, the inner cluster of 8 engines and the outer rings of 20 can clearly be seen. And with a little help from Caspar Stanley and his awesome creativity, we can even visualize the whole thing in 3D and most likely what it will look like installed inside the booster. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server, where you can meet me and the rest of the community or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie or cap and look as awesome as you feel. Links can be found in the description. You rock! So this is it, one of the most complex fuel distribution systems ever designed for a rocket. This of course is take one. It's a complex problem to solve and SpaceX will likely go through a couple of iterations until they find the most efficient variant. Here's the centerpiece that was photographed by Mary just with the center cluster of 8 Raptor engines attached. And here it is again with all the engines attached, an impressive amount of pipes. That's what you need to get a Starship into orbit, the combined force of 28 Raptor engines firing for 169 seconds. To be able to recover Starships though, SpaceX will need heat tiles, lots of heat tiles. Here for example we have a segment of serial number 17 and it has lots and lots of heat tiles on it. What can be seen quickly though is that this can't be anywhere close to the final product. The tiles break off on occasion, the placement is not symmetrical and on the sides we can also see that the tiles are tilted in all sorts of directions. This is not a smooth surface at all and every irregularity gives the heat a point of attack when a Starship re-enters the atmosphere. SpaceX is practicing a lot. Where in the beginning a heat tile was a sensation on its own, they are a common sight now. Every prototype is more and more covered with them and the SpaceX workforce is practicing on how to build the perfect Starship heat shield. On we go with cryojacket construction at the Sanchez site. Besides being the place to build huge segments for the launch support structure, the site has become a second construction site recently. SpaceX is constructing huge tank jackets here. As soon as they are finished, these will be sleeved over the new GSE tanks at the launch site and flooded with nitrogen. This will provide an excellent insulation for the cryogenic tanks, enabling SpaceX to store cryogenic commodities over a long time. And here's the next epic milestone at the SpaceX South Texas launch site. Do you remember the Liebherr LR-13-350 crane from episode 164? It's fully assembled by now, ready for the task of stacking hundreds of tons of heavy launch tower segments on top of each other. Here you can see how the work crew raised the power boom assembly. This is one of the largest mobile cranes on the planet, built for the toughest tasks there are. And here's what the Liebherr LR-13-350 was preparing for. What you're looking at here is Lab Pare's 24/7 live cam feed directly from Boca Chica, Texas, and it shows something huge traveling down Highway 4 towards the launch site. It's the first of 5 segments that will in the end make up the entire tower. Built at the Sanchez site and moved to the launch site when ready, SpaceX chose to pre-assemble them and stack when ready. This gives SpaceX the advantage of being able to do the heavy work on the ground. The tower is supposed to be more than 140 meters tall in the end and working at these heights can be very dangerous. By assembling separate segments and moving them over to the launch site for stacking, SpaceX avoids this and speeds up construction at the same time. It won't be long until we see the whole tower standing tall at the Boca Chica coastline, ready to support the first orbital Starship launch in human history. We're learning more and more about how SpaceX will assemble the tower on site as well. A work elevator has been lifted inside the tower structure showing that SpaceX is getting ready for the assembly. It is a MCDONOUGH US-61RX and it uses a rack and pinion system. It doesn't need cables and will run along a girder structure. It is unknown if SpaceX will only use this lift for the assembly work or if it will stay attached to the tower. One thing is for sure though, this will make the construction process much quicker. The orbital fuel farm has seen some major upgrades as well with new tanks being delivered and installed. All this effort shows that SpaceX is not just building a second tank farm like the one they already had. This whole facility is to replace the old tank farm in the end. According to SpaceX's internal plans, this is one of 2 new orbital tank farms as well, so expect the building to continue here for some time. SpaceX's priority number one right now is the orbital flight. Since serial number 15 has landed, the tempo and the direction SpaceX is moving into have changed. Hops do not seem to be the biggest priority anymore, and SpaceX is putting all the power they have into preparation for the orbital flight. It's unknown if SpaceX is still tracking July 1st for the first flight, but right now an August 1st or even September look more realistic. Exciting times in Boca Chica. Spaceport America Virgin Galactic launch. The next topic is all about one of the coolest looking rides to space ever built. Virgin Galactic's Spaceship 2, or Unity, is Richard Branson's take on space tourism, and it's just done its third flight to space. Spaceport, America, New Mexico, May 22nd, 2021. Virgin Galactic is getting ready to make history. VSS Unity, hanging under VMS Eve, is setting out to become the first manned vehicle to be launched into space from New Mexico. White Knight 2 and Spaceship 2 are working as a team to be able to deliver passengers to space. Virgin Galactic's goal is to make a trip to space actually somewhat affordable. Where Jeff Bezos is auctioning off the first seat on a new Shepard rocket for roughly $3 million right now, Virgin Galactic's current ticket price is standing at $250,000.
2, 1, release. Fire.
And for those $250,000, you're supposed to get this. Here you can see the two astronauts CJ Sturkoff and Dave McKay pilot VSS Unity at a top speed of Mach 3 and to an altitude of 89.23 kilometers. And for those who do not think that this is space, take a close look at the pictures. There's no doubt that this journey can be called very unique, and as long as there's no Starship flight available yet, $250,000 to get to space sounds pretty amazing. Virgin's Spaceship Unity, or short VSS Unity as Virgin Galactic calls its latest toy, is a so-called suborbital spaceplane, meaning that it cannot achieve orbit similar to Blue Origin's New Shepard rocket. Contrary to Blue Origin, Virgin Galactic chose to take the glider approach, which created a very unique plane, to say the least. Powered by a Rocket Motor 2 hybrid rocket engine that runs on hydroxyl terminated polybutadiene, the spaceplane is capable of creating 310 kilonewtons of thrust with a specific impulse of 250 seconds and a total burn time of 60 seconds. The plane has a built-in feather mechanism that can make the whole back part of the plane tilt for aerodynamic reasons. Virgin Galactic fulfilled a number of test objectives during the flight too. Unity carried revenue-generating scientific research experiments as part of NASA's Flight Opportunities program. It collected data to be used for the final two verification reports that are required as part of the current FAA Commercial Reusable Spacecraft Operators license. It tested the spaceship's upgraded horizontal stabilizers and flight controls. And on top of that, CJ, who flew as pilot in command, becomes the first person ever to have flown to space from three different states. After the successful flight, VSS Unity landed safely back at Spaceport America, demonstrating a full flight without any problems. With this successful test, Virgin Galactic is on the final stretch to be able to get the FAA license required to start the boarding process for hopefully many flights to come in the future. $250,000 for a flight on VSS Unity. Would you do it if you had the money readily available? Tell me in the comments, what's your thought about space tourism? Today's episode is brought to you by the Ridge Wallet. It's light, sleek, and industrial. It doesn't fold or awkwardly bulge in your pocket, and it seriously changed my whole pocket situation. So much for the official message. Ridge asked me to try out their wallet for free and if I'd like it to show to you what I'd like the most. I gave it a try. That was 4 weeks ago. I am one of those habit people when it comes to my wallets. I don't change stuff. Even though I took everything out of the old wallet and carried the Ridge wallet around every day. It holds up to 12 cards plus room for cash. There's over 30 colors and styles including carbon fiber and burnt titanium. It has 30,000 five-star reviews. It's so durable it comes with a lifetime warranty. You can buy it and carry it for the rest of your life, and the Ridge team is so confident that you'll like it that they'll let you test drive it for 45 days. You can send it back for a full refund if you don't love it. And frankly, after giving it a try for a month, I know why. There was so much stuff in my old wallet and I thought I had to have all of it with me all the time. When I changed to the Ridge wallet, I thought the space would never be enough. I was wrong. One of my rules for sponsoring is to only advertise products that I personally like. This is one of them. I'll never return back to my old wallet ever again. To make the most awesome wallet switch of your life and at the same time support What About It, go to rich.com/felix. That's rich.com/felix and use the code FELIX to get 10% off today with free worldwide shipping and returns. Change your pocket situation with Rich. Links in the description. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Ron Gum, Jimmy Long, Martin Cusack, Viper B, Andreas, Count Codys, Daryl Feingold, Leandro Cura, and many others. You rock, and thank you so much for all the unbelievable amount of help we're getting. We're past 1500 supporters now, and many of them can be found on our Discord server. If you're a supporter and you're not on our Discord server yet, make sure to join now. I'd love to thank you in person. Boca Chica coastline. Coastline. The orbital fuel farm. Hydroxyl terminated polybutadiene. Yo. After its very successful flight, Sirian this is just going to get insane. Go with Sirian. To fly to orbit. What? Besides. Come on.